So how are you all doing today? I want you to know what you all have done to me. You hear that, y'all, constantly? We did programs in California and New Mexico and Denver, and I couldn't get rid of this. I couldn't get rid of it. Now can you hear me? Great. Good. So, you know, I go to different parts of the country now. We're doing programs now in 15 states. 15 states we're doing programs, and we were only going to do 30, 35 programs this year, because last year I got burned out doing 44 programs. So this year we were only going to do 30, 35, and now we're at 38. And I still got about another 20 to go. So we're going to be getting around the country still, and the reason why all these are happening is that people are contacting our organization, and they're asking us to get grants to do programs in their cities, because nobody gets to see programs like the types of programs that we provide that is more than just one drug. All right, you go to a lot of the pharmaceutical programs, you're going to listen about one medication. You come to our program, and you get to hear our speakers talk about all the different medications that are available, and sometimes you get to hear about the symptoms, or you'll get to hear from, now we have a patient advocate, Don McNeil, who you'll hear from later on, and you all got to give him a big, you know, roll tide, right? So, right, so you got to go there too, all right? But you know, the purpose of these programs is to educate you and educate your caregivers, because, you know, MS is not a death sentence. You all have to know this. MS is not a death sentence. You get diagnosed, you get your medication, and you live your life. And that's all we want you to do, is we want you to have the best quality of life that you can. And so we want you to be educated with all the different things, all the different medications that are out there. And just know that there are therapies, there are medications, there are people that are here to work with you. And just about everything or anything that could be wrong with you in your disease state, there is something these days to help you get beyond that and help you to live. All right, so I'm not gonna sit up here and babble because I could talk to you all day long, and instead, let's just welcome up Dr. Samuel Hunter, who's here today from Franklin, Tennessee, to speak with you all.
All right, well, it's my pleasure to get to come and meet you all. I don't get down to this region very much, even though it's not that far. I'm a neurologist. I've been in neurology for 30 years, actually more than that now, and a big background in MS, and I treat a lot of people with MS. What I hope to be able to do in this kind of setting is give you a more complete big picture view than you would get at an industry-sponsored setting. We have some very strict ways of being able to talk when physicians work with industry. That means the government censors a lot of what we say, and you're going to hear some things that you may not have heard before. Are we set with the slides to go? Yeah, great. And we'll get started here. I got a lot of information. I hope to both entertain you and inform you, because it's a very interesting topic, and people with multiple sclerosis need to understand what the good things that are happening are happening all the time, and it's always changing. So we're going to talk about how therapy has changed through the last 600 years. And it's mostly changed the last 20 years, so it gets a little interesting. And I think it's a point of great optimism in that you have become a market, and billions of dollars have been spent trying to find better treatments. We got 14 approved treatments. There are more coming. There are 9 different ways these treatments worked. We've got a couple medicines for treating relapses. Other medicines we know are effective. We'll talk a little bit about there, but I do want to say, because one of the number one questions I get is about what do we do with stem cells. Stem cells is not a treatment for MS. Aggressive chemotherapy is on occasion used to treat MS, and doctors who are experienced in using cancer chemotherapy give stem cells on occasion to prevent deaths from the high-dose chemotherapy. Anyone who offers you stem cell treatment for cash is a quack practitioner. It's somebody who wants to line their pockets, and they're not a well-trained physician or neurologist. So that, and I'll explain more about those aspects to you. But those are not things that all but a tiny fraction of people with MS need to be concerned about. So what I am going to tell you is how we got our therapies today and where we're going, and give you the big picture of things that the government won't always let us tell you in an industry-sponsored talk. But progress is very slow, and we have everything we have because of people like you with MS who spend time donating their time and their bodies to research while they are alive, not after they're dead. And these researches, studies are only possible because people spend their time and effort getting into them and helping us learn things. It's all about disability in MS. And disability is measured on a scale in neurology, and our disability scale ranges from I can't tell there's anything wrong with you to a pine box. Obviously, we don't want anybody to get any disability, but the reality of MS is most people have some disability by the time we get a diagnosis, and most people are going to have more disability as time goes by despite efforts, but it's a whole lot less than it used to be, and dramatically less so. We can't measure some disabilities well. We have more trouble measuring cognitive disability, and we have more trouble measuring fatigue. And fatigue, mood, sleep, pain, and cognitive issues are things that don't show up on our disability scales. So when we talk about disability from point of view of treating MS, we're not talking about those. And I'm not going to be talking about the symptomatic treatments for MS. I'm going to be talking about treatment for relapses and preventing disability. All right, what is a relapse? They're symptoms that you notice. They're not things that are there most of the time or fluctuate. They last more than a day. They usually come on over days or weeks. They usually last weeks or months. It's really hard to have more than four relapses in a year because of the length of time. If people are having more relapses than that, it's really most of them are kind of grouped together. The disease is very, very active. Relapses usually come on more slowly and are milder when people are on therapy. And what we learned long, long ago with MS is that early on, the disease activity that shows up clinical basis as relapses determines who's going to get worse faster. And the more relapses people have, the faster their legs get worse. And so this is using a cane. The people who have more than two relapses a year are very rapidly end up with limited gaits, whereas people who have them on a much lower rate take much longer to reach that milestone. The squirrely thing about MS is if you get MS when you're a young person, you know, when you're 18 years old, you're going to have walking problems on average when you're 40. And if you get it when you're 40 years old, you already have walking problems. The nervous system doesn't put up with punishment well as we get older, and it's really critical that we get the disease controlled as quickly as possible to get people freedom from disability. And we don't just put people on treatment. We monitor their treatment, and we change their treatment if necessary to get them better controlled. Where does MS start? Well, it starts in the 14th century, where we have the first historical documentation of somebody who had MS. We're pretty sure it sounds just like MS. It's a young woman named Ludwina of Schiedam. She is now a saint in the Catholic Church, and she's the patron saint of figure skaters because she was a figure skater, and she originally had blindness and fell when she was a young woman and developed progressive limb weakness, and she attributed all her medical difficulties that we would recognize as MS to problems with evil spirits. And she was a very controversial mystic in the church. And here there are a couple of pictures of her being visited by angels and visions that she had. But she was somebody who we can point to as the first time someone really described the disease in a way that we can recognize it centuries later. There wasn't a lot of information that went on about MS for hundreds of years. And of course, people had MS. We didn't recognize them. And this gentleman is a doctor who did not deal with MS directly. He probably saw it. But he was recognized for what he did with the immune system. And it was the first time that really scientifically somebody had taken a illness, and in this case it was the illness smallpox, which was the most feared disease 200, 300 years ago because it killed so many people and kept killing. And he demonstrated that you could prevent the disease. Now, other people had shown this. He wasn't the first, but he was the first one to systematically do it and report it and make it practical. And he did it in a fairly unethical way, but he learned this just by paying attention to what people said. And it was well known that people wouldn't get smallpox if they were milkmaids because they'd been infected with a virus that looked like that. And they didn't know what viruses were, but they knew that if you'd had this, you didn't get smallpox, and he purposely infected a young boy with smallpox who had been immunized previously with the cowpox, which is what we used up until many of the people in this room probably got vaccinia back in the 60s when they stopped doing it, which was leaves a big scar on your arm if it worked right. And this is why smallpox is gone. So this guy was important. The next guy who's important is 100 years later. And this is the guy who really got the ball rolling. And this is before we had any treatment or any inkling of how to do with MS. In fact, you'll be quite alarmed when you find out how they treated people with MS. This was Dr. Charcot, who is considered the father of neurology because of his great status in teaching and learning. And he was in charge of no less an important place than the Sane Asylum in Paris. And that is where people with neurologic problems were usually found because they didn't understand them, they didn't know what they were, and they scared people. And Dr. Charcot was the very first symptom to really recognize what MS looked like in lifetime and to describe it. And he noted that these people had eye movement problems and trouble walking and slurred speech. And then he put that together with the appearance of the illness in the brain, which he named sclerose en plaques. And it's still called that in French. And it basically means hard spots. In English, it became multiple sclerosis. It was actually called disseminated sclerosis for a time. And this doctor was the one who put together the findings in the brain with the actual illness. Not much happened in MS in a long time. In fact, the things that happened were more than 50 years later, but this gentleman came along. He's a very important scientist. He by the name of Pasteur. Pasteur was a microbiologist, a bacteriologist, and he did some very important things for us. But he also created a disease that is like MS. Now, he's famous for curing rabies, and he's famous for inventing pasteurization to preserve milk. But in the process of curing rabies, he actually caused a disease that's like MS that has given us a lot of insight. And that disease we call vaccine encephalitis. And it happened because of a complication of using the rabies vaccine, which he developed from rabbits. And they would inject a rabbit spinal cord that had killed the virus into people who'd been exposed to rabies to prevent them from getting rabies. But unfortunately, a small fraction of people would get a serious and sometimes fatal neurologic disease. And this was not very well understood for a long, long time. Until later, we had understood that MS was an immune disease. And during the First World War, a very famous pathologist who was a Scottish citizen was unable to participate in the war because he had TB. And he published a really seminal article that MS looked like an infection. And he equated it to syphilis. Syphilis is a disease that we don't see very much anymore because it's very treatable now. But he thought MS was an infection because there were a lot of immune cells there. And he published a paper where he used the term at that time, which was disseminated sclerosis, and he actually described the features that are typical of MS for the first time as a pathological entity, and I'll show you what those look like. And then he subsequently went on to discover another disease that was like MS that we now call SSPE, and it's an extinct disease in this part of the world because it was caused by the measles virus. And it was an MS-like virus, MS-like disease that went on and it disappeared once we had vaccination for the measles. So That said, we can't prove that MS is caused by any particular infection. We know that people with MS have more problems with certain viruses, but there's no consistent infection found in the brain of them. We know MS is an immune disease. What kind of immune disease is it? Well, we know the immune system keeps going into the brain, and everybody's different. It's slow in some and fast in others. And this name sclerosis is from the original description of the hard spots that Dr. Charcot made in the different parts of the nervous system. But the inflammatory component of it was pointed out by Dr. Dawson. Well, these are Dr. Dawson's fingers in people's brains. Markings where you see these round or oval spots that track through the brain along veins, and they're produced by inflammation. This is equivalent of acne in your brain. It's very similar. It's actually milder than acne, and it leaves scars in the brain we call black holes. It leaves these little holes where the brain tissue is severely injured. Now, most of the MS lesions don't leave black holes. They're smaller. It's just the severe ones. But this is a term we still use, and we recognize immediately if people have them that they have MS, although you don't have to have Dawson's fingers to have MS. What the immune system's doing is it's invading the brain. And these cells we now call T cells, which have been known as that class of lymphocytes for about 40 or 50 years, are the instigators, and then they call in other cells to interfere with the function of the brain tissue. And this results in the loss of many elements of the connections in the brain. First of all, the insulation we call myelin, and second of all, it actually disrupts some of the nerve fibers. And what the pathologists were able to show and see is that this inflammation is there. And what you're looking at here in the upper picture is inflammatory cells coming out of a blood vessel and disseminating all these little blue spots through the brain tissue. And then we very highly magnify it, the inflammatory cells, these are the nerve fibers, and the red is the insulation along the nerve fibers. And you can see it coming off as the inflammatory cells are in between. And this little blue spot that you can barely see here is a disrupted nerve fiber or axon. And the inflammatory cells that are in the brain are many types. They're T cells, which are mostly the ones that are promoting it right around the blood vessel. And then there are monocytes, which are a kind of cleanup cell called a macrophage that are throughout the tissue, and then B cells set up shop in there, which are another kind of lymphocyte. And we have treatments that work on all these kinds of cells, one or more types. All our treatments address this inflammatory process in one way or another, either starting it or finishing it, and reduce the amount of new injury in the brain. So you hear a lot about myelin. Myelin is the glue that kind of holds the brain together in these connections, and it makes the nerve fibers very efficient and safe, and it helps support their metabolism. But when the inflammatory cells, which are these blue dots, invade the brain, it goes away, and this is normal myelin over here, and there'll be these well-demarcated areas. Now, the myelin can repair, and it often does. It usually does, in fact, for a long time. It's only the more severe areas that aren't completely repaired. And what can't repair is the nerve cells themselves. So when a nerve cell is lost, it's a permanent loss. But myelin can recover really badly damaged areas. Probably if it recovered, it wouldn't do any good. All right. So in order to treat people, you have to know how to study the disease. It's very hard to study people. You can only ask very simple questions with people. Does this work? Do they get better? Do they get worse? How quickly? Does it make them sick? With animals, you can do many more kinds of questions much faster. And so a good animal model was needed, and that was found by this gentleman. And he basically built on Dr. Pasteur's work. He discovered that you can inject mice with spinal cord. which is what they did with the rabies vaccine. And if you threw in there something that really made the immune system turn on, which was dead TB bacteria, then these animals would get an illness just like that in their brain, an inflammatory illness in the nervous system. And they would come down, they would get paralyzed, like this mouse is paralyzed. They might not get better. Obviously, we don't have good nursing care for mice, so that might have been the end of the mouse. And this inflammation in the brain and spinal cord is called EAE for short, experimental or autoimmune encephalitis, or it goes by other names with the same letters. And it's the most widely used animal model of multiple sclerosis, and it was the breakthrough that was needed for there to begin to be scientific work, and it's still used today, although this is not MS. It's a disease that's like MS, and it's used to study MS. So what about treatment? I tell you all this because we're going to talk about treatment for MS and the different treatments. And how the treatments work has to do with what kind of disease it is. But before 1950, we didn't have any treatment that worked for MS at all. Nothing worked. And they treated MS like any other disease, whatever seemed to be the problem, and the kind of poor quality medicine that we had until the scientific age was applied to MS as well. So people got hot or cold baths. They had enemas or laxatives. They got treated with things that made them feel better sometimes, like incense. You know, cupping, which you might have seen at the Olympics, this is just as ineffective now as it was 3,000 years ago. And then old antibiotics, which were arsenic and mercury before we had penicillin, which were just as bad as the disease always. And as I told you earlier, until the early 20th century, people with MS who were bad often found themselves in an insane asylum because people were scared of the problems they had. They didn't understand it. They didn't know what to do with it. And they just locked them up. So it was well into our 20th century before we had any beneficial therapy for MS. All right. Who brought the first one here? It was these two gentlemen from Mayo Clinic. They shared the Nobel Prize for the discovery of cortisone and the brain hormone that makes its production, which is called ACTH, in 1948. And all the steroids chemically are derived from the same source in their chemistry. And these guys brought basically a miraculous anti-inflammatory drug to the world. And that was what we generally still call cortisone or steroids, but not the bodybuilding kind of steroids. They're anti-inflammatory steroids. And they revolutionized arthritis. They actually, Dr. Hench over here was a rheumatologist who started the treatment of in that specialty. And neurologists for MS borrowed what they had learned from treating these diseases into treating MS. And they began to use steroids to treat MS and related medicines. And the discovery of this hormone called ACTH actually led to the first approved treatment for multiple sclerosis, which is called ACTH, and it was used to treat MS and other inflammatory brain diseases. Around this time, the interferons were discovered. We didn't know what they were. They just knew they were proteins. They could see them in experimental settings, that these signals went out to turn on defenses against viruses between cells. And 50 years later, they got approved for MS. So the first thing we learned to do was to treat relapses. Why? Because we understood that it was an inflammatory disease, and they used medicines that calmed down inflammation. The first research trial was actually in 1969 that showed this. Of course, there were some people who were doing this before then, but you wanted to get scientific evidence that it worked, and this actually led to the government approving this medicine, which is still approved, and the gentleman out there with the booth for HP Actar Gel is still selling this product, which is the original one that was used. It's more commonly used nowadays, but methylprednisolone, which is commonly referred to as solumedrol, is the kind of steroids that most people get when they have a relapse, which are very large doses for a few days to calm down. And cortisol medicines have a lot of side effects. That limits them And MS doctors learn to use these largely from the rheumatologists. And that's where we got our treatments from relapses. And we use very large doses of steroids, or we use a large dose of ACTH injection to treat relapses to this day. All right. Now, something wonderful happened. We learned how to look into people's heads without them being dead. And we couldn't do that until the 1970s. And the first thing that came along was something we call the CAT scan now, or CT. But the actual breakthrough that happened back in the 40s and 50s was a technology called NMR, which allowed chemically us to look at molecules and be able to understand what the molecule was like. This wasn't applied to imaging till long after CT, and what most people don't know is that the CT scanner actually came about because the Beatles were such a successful company. Their record label, EMI, had so much money laying around that they had to invest it, and they invested in a crazy idea that a professor had that produced a Nobel Prize and gave the first pictures in life. CT scanners aren't that useful for MS. They don't show MS very well because it's a soft tissue process and they show bones better. It was the MRI imaging that came about in the 1980s from work that was done in the 70s by several people. The doctor who got the Nobel Prize was the more elegant person. This guy was kind of a cad, and he wasn't appreciated. He took out a full page add the New York Times to complain when they didn't give him a New York Times. But he didn't get this Nobel. But this is what changed MS forever. It showed us that a lot more people had MS than we thought. And then the contrast agent was discovered subsequently that showed us what inflammatory medicines looked like. And we understood for the first time we could see MS lesions in progress that caused problems, and we could see MS lesions that didn't cause problems. So what this was is some pictures that were done in the late 1980s over the course of a year in a patient who had multiple sclerosis. And this is a person, this is before we had effective treatments to stop relapses, this is a person who is not treated and has no new symptoms. And what we realized is this is not a disease that stops or remits. And to this period, they had called MS an attack disease that had remissions. And what we realized is that this inflammation is going on all the time in parts of the nervous system that people don't know about. And we're looking at, over the years, these problems adding up over time. This was the epiphany. We needed to understand how to treat MS and how to add the use of MRI to finding new therapies. The other thing that we learned in the 90s is our brain is affected in ways that we didn't understand from MS, and that the uncontrolled MS causes us to lose brain tissue. And what you see is here is not over a year, but over 7 years in someone who's not on treatment, with them losing brain tissue because of the damage that's inflicted by the immune system. And our effective treatments prevent both the new lesions and the loss of brain volume, which leads to an early aging of the brain. All right. So what went on to happen? Well, due to the fact that we had animal models, they started looking for new ways to treat MS. And the Weizmann Institute, which is an Israeli scientific institute, began to attempt to design a protein in the 1960s that would modify the immune system response in the brain. Well, they actually set out to try to cause the disease, and they ended up preventing it. We also discovered how to manipulate cells. And what we called genetic engineering back then. And genetic engineering led to the ability to produce molecules that we had not been able to before, that were natural molecules. Now we could engineer them. And they thought this was going to be a cure for cancer. But it worked for a few kinds of cancers, but it really worked well for hepatitis and MS. And it's what changed MS and got us the first medications on the market. So how do we want to monitor disease? Well, we want to have ways to measure it. Relapses were the most obvious way to monitor the disease. Relapses gave us something that we could see happen that made a difference to people. And so almost all our treatments are approved on the basis of decreasing the number of relapses or their severity. But the ultimate thing we want to do is prevent disability, and we have scales like EDSS, which is a complicated old scale that mainly depends on how your legs work, to measure MS, but we have ones that look at how you think and how your hands move. And then we have the MRI, which, believe it or not, MRI has very little to do with what is going on with people's arms and legs. Why is that? Because most of that tissue that you see on the MRI scan has to do with your thinking, not your arms and legs. It is an important area of the brain, and we can see, because it's a bellwether for what's going on in the rest of the body, what's going on above your ears, where it's very hard to examine. But the disease that people notice is in the input and output pathways in the brain. It's the sensation and coordination, and the longest pathways are damaged the most, which is why legs and bladder are such an issue in MS. But those don't show up as well on MRI, or they're due to much smaller problems in the nervous system. So when we pick treatments for people with MS, there are a lot of factors. If you're an insurance company, you want the one that's cheapest or the company that gives you the best deal. If you're a patient, you want the one that works the best or has the least side effects or is the least trouble or costs you the less, depending on what the issues are. Everybody's different, but all of these things go into MS outcomes. And there is no perfect one medicine for everybody with MS. Everybody has to look at different factors, and we make a compromise in medicine. We start with one medicine that looks like it should work, and if that doesn't work, we go on to another medicine. We tend to take more risks as we need to take more risks because the disease isn't controlled. All right. So where did we get our medicines? Well, the Weizmann Institute discovered what we now call copaxone. It's called copolymer 1. It was probably the simplest kind of chemical development we could ever have had. And, you know, that medicine took nearly 40 years to get on the market after they discovered it in the United States, and it's now actually available even as a generic. And they showed that it worked in animals. And the doctor that first tested it was amazed because it cut down 40% of the MS relapses in people when he tested it in New York City. This is the proper name from the drug glatiramer. It's actually derived from the amino acids that are in it, and it's basically an allergy shot for your brain that affects the behavior of the T lymphocytes. It makes them harder to respond to brain proteins, and it directs them to become a friendlier type of cell, and it's now available 3 times a week. And it's still widely used medicine. And this is the data from the original trial that was done where the people in blue got glatiramer acetate from the beginning, and the people in purple here for the first 3 years got an inactive medication and then went on glatiramer acetate. And this is the changes that these people experienced over years in their disability. And what happens is the people who were untreated these first 3 years, that group is worse, and they never ever come back to where the people were who were treated from the beginning. And what we have this many times with MS medicines, we've realized that a few years make a big difference. And I'll show you an even more dramatic example of this in the moment. Now, we have interferons. We're the other class of medicine, and there's one kind of interferon we don't use for MS called gamma interferon, but interferons originally they got from some kind of cells that they happened to make interferon, but this didn't make enough interferon, and subsequently, doctors in got interested in interferon in MS because it did things to cells. And the doctor who originally tested interferon for MS did it because there was a lot of MS in Buffalo, New York. And there is a lot of MS in Buffalo, New York. And he thought, well, if we're going to test interferon for something, we should test it for MS. And he did. And then the industry got interested, and someone out on the West Coast figured out how to make interferon reliably and cheap, and this became a medicine that we now know as beta-seron and Xtavia, and it includes a number of molecules. Around this time, doctors started to use for the first time aggressive chemotherapy regimens also to try to control the inflammatory nature of MS. So beta-seron made it on the market. The way beta-seron, Avonex, Plegridy, Xtavia, and Rebif all work is they turn on viral defenses. They make the immune system get ready for an infection. And when it does this, it calms down certain immune cells and it stimulates others. And so it pushes a lot of buttons in the immune system. These basically make the immune system stay put rather than go after your brain. And this is a very effective way to treat MS, and we'll talk about how effective it was. It was a brilliantly engineered molecule. Subsequent advances result in the other times, and even though it failed for cancer and for chronic hepatitis, it began testing for MS, and it amazed everyone because in the first trial they did, nobody had a relapse. And larger trials were resulted in the approval of the drug. It was the very first disease-modifying drug that was approved for MS in 1990. And you had to get it in a lottery. It was in such demand. And it's cost effective. And it's still used. And it still saves lives. And I'm going to show you that data here in a minute. But the interferon beta 1A, which is a more human type of molecule, came along. And it's been come to market in several forms. Another chemotherapy drug was discovered for MS in the 90s, and that drug, mitoxantrone, isn't used much in the U.S. because of its serious complications of heart problems and cancer. Now, this is what interferon beta looks like, and this is what beta-seron looks like. It's kind of a stripped-down version of the human, and people a lot of times get upset when they find out these things are made in hamster cells. Hamster cells are just little factories that we have. They have nothing to do with hamsters, and no hamsters are harmed in the production of the medicine. These are cells that have lived in petri dishes for 50 or 60 years. And interferon beta is actually made in our friend E. coli that lives in our intestines. But what they found when they used interferon was they could reduce MS relapses by as much as half. They could put them off for as twice as long as what normally they would take to occur. And that doesn't even talk about how bad they were. And when Rebif was tested, when it came to market, it made the time to getting worse twice as long. So these were the mainstays of MS therapy up until about 10 years ago. You hear a lot from people that nothing works for progressive MS, and I have to tell you that's absolutely not true. That is said because that is what the government requires the pharmaceutical industry to say, because they haven't formally approved medicines for people with progressive MS, except for mitoxantrone, which is that chemotherapy medicine we don't use much anymore. And mitoxantrone certainly works for progressive MS, and there are plenty of research trials that show people with progressive MS benefit. In fact, there are research trials that show if you don't treat people with progressive MS, they get much worse. And this was one of them. This was a trial done in the 1990s in Europe with people who were somewhat younger and had progressive MS, and they actually had to stop this trial because the people who got beta-seron did so much better than the people who were on an inactive medicine that they had to stop the trial after 2 years because it wasn't ethical not to treat the people who were untreated. But our government keeps you from being told these things because of bureaucratic reasons. And so you won't ever hear that from a pharmaceutical industry. And if you ask them that, they will get very alarmed and the blood will drain out of their face because the government will come around and fine them $1 billion if they offend them. It is that bad a situation. All right, so where are we? Well, when we get to this century now, 600 years after St. Ludwina, we've got effective treatment for MS. It's not the world's easiest to do treatment. They're injections, and it doesn't work for everybody. And we have some chemotherapy drugs, which are not easy to take and not that safe. We've completely redefined MS because of MRIs. And now we get new medicines. We get oral medications. And we get some new bioengineered drugs called monoclonal antibodies. And these are a lot of them. And monoclonal antibody is a mouthful, but it just means an engineered antibody. And antibodies are made by our immune system, and we're full of them. And they're what protect us against all the bugs that we live in. But you can engineer in anybody to react with almost anything. So one of these was natalizumab or Tysabri. One is alemtuzumab or Lemtrada. And one's rituximab or Rituxan. And there's many others. And you're going to hear more about these. And Nobel Prizes have been awarded for these technologies. These drugs have changed cancer, rheumatoid arthritis, and MS dramatically. So we're going to talk about these, including the oral medicines, and the advances in some of the MRI technology have been really important to understanding what these medicines do. We've also redefined MS. We didn't used to call the first episode of symptoms MS, but we do now. The government made them call it clinically isolated syndrome, and now they just call it early MS. I guess they got tired of spelling that. But this includes people who start with any kind of neurological symptom that's related to MS. And what we've learned from doing research is that if you have an abnormal MRI and you have any symptom that's typical for MS, about half of people will have another relapse within 2 years. And 90% of people will have another MRI lesion that shows it's typical MS within 2 years. But because we have research data that treating people from the very first symptom makes people do 50% better, and most people won't have any more relapses, everybody should be treated from the first symptom. All right, this is an example of one of those research trials with this kind of dramatic benefit that was conducted about 10 years ago, where people had a first symptom and they were randomly assigned to either placebo or betaseron at the first symptom. And the people who were on betaseron, it took twice as long for them to have another symptom. And in fact, these people, this year difference in symptoms is translated out for the next 7 to 12 years in terms of doing better. So people should not wait for a second symptom to control MS. Nowadays, we talk about how much treatment can make you better. And treatment does make you better. And this is data from that same trial that showed the people who got betaseron just 1 year earlier ended up with their brains working better. They were able to multitask faster than the people who waited 1 to 2 years to go on treatment. It's an important difference. What else is different with early treatment? I show you this with betaseron because they've got the data. And you're not allowed to see it if they do a program or anybody else does a program. This company stopped doing programs a long time ago because the government won't let them show you anything except what was done in 1993. But if you looked at people who weren't treated, their MRI disease went up. If you looked at people who were ever treated, their MRI disease had gone down. If you looked at people who were treated continuously, their MRI disease had gone way down. And this is generally true of many of our MS medicines. It certainly was true to high-dose interferon. And the problem with some of our MS medicine is not that they don't work, but they're hard to take. All right. The biggest thing about early treatment is it saves lives. And people say, well, God, I just don't know anybody who dropped over dead from MS. And the answer is they don't. They die younger. And what you see for a difference of 3 years in starting treatment is a 50% difference in when people die. And so these are the folks that got inactive treatment for 3 years. That's here. And here we are 20 years later, and they're twice as likely to have died. Why is that? Well, obviously the treatment does something very good for you. But what it does is it mainly produces protection against disability later on. And people with MS die from disability, and the reason you die from disability is you get pneumonia. Go get your pneumonia vaccine. All right. We still had to deal a lot with people who think that they have benign MS. Benign MS is a term that neurologists like to use because they didn't have any treatment for MS and you didn't want people to feel bad. And if you're really bad enough that we had to tell you you had MS, this is back in the 80s when I first started working, we didn't tell people they had MS because we couldn't do anything about it, even though we knew they had MS. I wasn't responsible for that decision. It was just the way they did things in neurology. But benign MS meant that you were never going to have a problem. And the fact is that 95% of people with MS are going to have a problem. If you're that lucky forever, God bless you. I wish we could put it in a bottle, but we can't do it. We do it with treatment. But for every 10 years somebody goes without disability, the chance is still more than 50% that they'll get it the next 10 years. All right. People are afraid of progressive disease. You notice I don't have this slide in here about the different types of MS. It's because most doctors don't believe it anymore. It's a very old treatment concept, and what we currently believe is that everybody has relapses and everybody has progression. Progression means you're getting worse and you can't tell when it happened. When somebody comes in the door and says, "Doctor, I'm progressively getting worse. I got so much worse back in March." That's not what neurologists call progression. That's a relapse when they got worse. It doesn't mean you got better. And the other word we've gotten rid of is remitting. Remitting because MS doesn't stop. I showed you those MRIs. It keeps going. Some people it keeps going slower, but most people it just keeps going. We can't really say when somebody got worse, and those people we use milestones. This concept of primary progressive MS, we've actually going to have a medicine to treat it. A lot of people are told they have primary progressive MS when they don't really have primary progressive MS because they've had relapses. And the fact is that if you look at people who are told they have primary progressive MS, about half of them will have a relapse in the space of 2 years. So it's very important to treat your MS. All right. What about difficult MS? Well, everybody knows that our treatments don't control everything, and that is a fact. And most people who are on treatment will still have some kind of new symptoms. How do you deal with that? Well, if you're having relapses or you're having new problems, you need to look at changing medication. It may be to go to an oral medicine if you're on an injectable medicine. It may be to go to a medicine that has a little more risks. We used to use older chemotherapy medicines. We don't use those very much anymore because we have medicines that are safer and more effective. And the newer monoclonal medicines, Tysabri has been around for 10 years. Lemtrada is the one that's come to market more recently. And there are other ones you will see approved in the future. What do these medicines get you? Well, in terms of relapses, between being untreated and being treated, it's a very, very big benefit. And this is several different trials. This was one with Tysabri. These two were with interferon beta or Copaxone. And you get a huge benefit for what doesn't happen. And this is hard to tell when you're on treatment. People often blame the trouble they're having on their treatment. Well, the fact is, it's going to be a lot worse off treatment. And so we try to solve these problems, and we have a lot of medicines available today to do it, and we'll have even more. But the importance of being on treatment is the most important point I can get across, because you will be far, far worse if you don't go on treatment. All right. Which was the first oral medicine? It was Gilenya. I didn't make up that name. It was called something else first. But fingolimod is the generic drug. You'll see generic fingolimod in 3 years. It was approved in 2010. It's an orally active drug that modulates how the immune system works. And I'll go through that with you. It's been very successful. It's twice as effective as interferon beta. So not only is it easier to take, it works better. The biggest obstacle to get it was insurance companies telling people they had to do badly on something else first. It has a major protection against brain shrinkage. The government will not let the company tell you that. It is an absolutely revolutionary drug in terms of how it protected people. In fact, nobody should take a really risky drug for MS if they can take Gilenya and it works well for them, because it is the biggest advance that we've ever had in MS, is a pill that people can take that the vast majority of people have no difficulties with. So the way it works is it makes your lymphocytes unable to find the brain. So they just hang out in your lymph nodes with nothing to do as long as that drug is around. And they stay there. It also directly benefits some of the brain cells. And it actually enhances the repair of the brain in animal models like MS. And this is something that's really important. Everybody wants to know about repairing myelin, remyelination. Well, let me tell you, I've been doing this for 30 years. I did the research for 30 years. The myelin repair happens. It happens with our effective medicines. When you control the inflammation, the brain gets better. We can't repair everybody. We can't make everything go away. But you see these people over time improve in disability. That is repair. All right. Gelini also improves mood. That's one of the nice things about it. Now, the mode of action, what happens is you've got lymph nodes, and you don't realize with MS, but your problem is actually in the lymph nodes. You feel it from the brain, but in the lymph nodes, there are new immune cells coming in there. They're seeing little pieces of brain molecules, and some of them react to it, and they turn on. And they say, I'm going to go find it. I've got 5 minutes. All right. And Gelinia stops that process, and it also works on the cells in the brain. All right, Aubagio, I'm being real slow. Aubagio is another orally active immunodrug. Turned out to be much more effective than we thought, but probably just because it's easy to take. It's similarly effective to interferon. You have to be careful not to get pregnant. And the only issue is those people with significant liver issues. You have to be sure you don't have TB and get tests regularly. And there is a way to get it out of your body if you have to. The way it works, we know exactly how it works. It blocks one single enzyme. It makes it hard for the immune cells to rapidly proliferate. And this is the whole way the immune system works. The lymphocytes are little killing machines. They're like the broom and the bucket in the Mickey Mouse movie where they keep dividing. Is that 10 or 15? 15? Oh, I got 15 minutes. I'm fine. All right. Tecfidera is the other oral drug. This is dimethyl fumarate. I'm not going to explain to you exactly how this works because there's great disagreement, and there's at least three different ways it may work. It's an orally active immunomodulator. It's 2 times a day. It's been very successful because of its safety plan. It's slightly more effective than Copaxone is, to give you a benchmark. The problem with this drug is it doesn't control the MRI disease as well as we'd like, and it doesn't control atrophy very well either. It does have a simple safety plan. You have to have blood counts to watch your lymphocytes. There is some major problems with the stomach tolerability of this medicine, and flushing can also occur, and that's the reason why many people can't take it. It also has a risk of serious brain infections called PML. PML is a kind of viral infection of the brain that is unexpected to occur normally, but occurs when the immune system is slowed down for long periods of time. This is our only oral medicine which has PML at a risk as high as 1 in 1,000. It also had a very significant risk of cancers in the research trials. As high as 3% of people in their research trials that were done by the company got life-threatening kinds of cancer. The company won't tell people this. And the government hasn't done anything about it. But, you know, this is why I tell you these things. These things get out and they get known, but you have to watch out because this is a well-tolerated medicine. It's going to control some people's MS. But you've got to do regular cancer surveillance with Tecfidera. Tecfidera, you need to have, if you're a woman, you need to do breast self-exams, you need to have mammograms and gynecologic exams. People who are older need colon screening, and everybody needs skin cancer screening. So what do you do when you haven't got control of your MS? What is your backup plan? Well, we have a couple medicines that are the backup plan. The newest one and the most effective one is called Imtrada. It was approved finally in the U.S. after many years of trying to get it approved, because it was already approved in the rest of the world. And about 10,000 people with MS signed a petition, got somebody fired in the government that was holding it up. And thank God, my congresswoman, got that done. It is 8 IV routine treatments in the office over the space of a year, and it erases and reboots the immune system to get those immune cells out. It suppresses the majority of MS relapses very effectively. It's more than twice as effective as a high-dose interferon. It has some risks. They are manageable medical risks of thyroid and rarer immune bleeding disorders that are straightforward and temporary illnesses. About 2% of the people will be hospitalized for a few days to manage one of these illnesses. And there are monthly labs that are done for more than 5 years to make sure that people don't have a problem that we can prevent before it actually appears. The other backup plan is Tysabri. You're probably familiar with Tysabri. It's been around a long time. It is an every 4 week IV treatment, and it's as high as 2 or 3% of people, though we know now, will get life-threatening brain infections. This is the big problem with Tysabri. It also requires every 4 week treatment, which is a lot of time in the doctor's office through the course of a year. There is a medicine coming that is not here yet called Ocrevus or Ocrelizumab, and this is a medicine that's given every 6 months IV. It works on the B cells rather than on the T cells, and it is an effective medicine. Its principal risks are infection and cancer. Now, where did these monoclonal antibodies come from? Well, actually, a doctor dreamed them up in the 1800s, but he didn't know how they were going to work. And it wasn't until the 1970s when a really brilliant scientist figured out how to make them, to engineer them, to fuse basically a tumor cell with a normal immune cell and get a cell that made these antibodies. And the very first antibody that was made was called Campath. And that is the drug that became Lemtrada. So it took from 1973 to 2014 for that medicine to make it to people with MS. All right. So the genetic engineering allowed them to make better and better antibodies. You know, they revolutionized treatment of cancer and rheumatoid arthritis with these antibodies. And although these medicines work for MS, it takes a very long time for them to get approved. So many of these things have been around for years and years and years. But to get them approved, it costs $1 billion. That's one of the reasons they're expensive. And monoclonals are two types. There are either types that destroy a cell, which are like Lemtrada, Ocrevus, and Rituxan, or they're in types that modify cell responses by blocking signals. And this is like Tysabri or Zimbrita. Zimbrita is a latecomer to MS. It was just approved. It works a little differently. We'll see if we have time to talk about it. But Tysabri, the problem is it works well. The downside to it is people's risk goes up over time, and allergic reactions occur, and often people need frequent MRIs. The way Tysabri works is it fills up the little handles that immune cells use to hold on to the brain. And Lemtrada is here. The thing about Lemtrada is it's known for is making people better. These were people with progressive MS. They tend to stay stable. People with relapsing MS got better, sometimes miraculously. This is the people on Rebif getting worse over time. These are the people who are on Lemtrada getting worse over time. So a medicine that's fantastically effective in the long term on relapses. These are the relapses on Lemtrada in the long term. These are the relapses on Rebif. All right. Zimbrita, I told you it's a recent medicine. This is a niche medicine. This is a medicine with a lot of risks. It's for people who can't take anything else with MS. It's about as effective as Gilenya. It makes your NK cells overactive, and that results in some problems with infections and liver injury and other autoimmune complications. But some people do very well with it, and it is an effective drug for many people with MS. It's injected once a month. You have to have liver tests before every injection. All right, new things coming. You'll see some more B-cell medicines. Ocrevus will be the first one. Probably it's approved. And I'm going to stop there, and I've been able to cover most of your issues with knowing therapy. Do we need to take questions now, or do we have time?
No, we're going to do that later.
We're going to take questions later. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next up, we're going to have Amanda Adcock. And after Amanda speaks is when we're going to have the Q&A for both Dr. Hunter and Amanda. And also, we didn't get to thank Teva earlier. You know, we rely on the pharmaceutical industry to bring us the, or to provide us the funding that we need to do all these programs. And so we do hope that all of you appreciate that we got Teva to help us do today's program, right? You all thankful? Great. Good, thank you. All right, so now, for those that don't know, Amanda, I remember when she first spoke for MS Views and News, which was the first time she spoke. And she's going to get a little embarrassed right now because, you know, we had her speak down in Mobile, and she was so nervous before she spoke that she didn't know how she was going to just get up there and be fluid. So I stood in the back of the room making faces at her to distract her and make her laugh and giggle while she was talking just so she could relax. And now she's become such a great speaker that she is so wanted everywhere, and we just have to keep her aboard and working with us all the time. So let's thank Amanda for being here today. And Amanda is a great nurse practitioner. Come on up, Amanda.
I think Stuart over-exaggerated that a little bit, but I appreciate it anyway. I am an MS certified nurse practitioner. As I tell a lot of people, the MS certification was harder than my nurse practitioner certification because it is such a varied disease, and everybody's is not the same, and it goes in such detail and such depth with symptoms. And I have spoke on symptom management before. I'm not going to do that right now. I'm going to talk about adherence to your disease modifying therapies. Dr. Hunter just told you about a lot of the therapies, so I'm going to kind of talk about why we need to take those. So I found this and I like it. Life is not what it's supposed to be, it's what it is. The way you cope with it is what makes the difference. So I guess none of you ever planned on having MS. Wasn't what you imagined life would be, wasn't how you imagined it would go. But now it is what it is, so let's talk about how to deal with it and why we should deal with it and why we should take our medicine. So any of you ever feel like this? Very overwhelmed. Needles coming in all directions, have a lot of medicines, trying to remember to take those. So there's a few types of MS medications. The first one there is called disease-modifying therapies, and that is the medicine that is going to keep you from having, hopefully, keep you from having any new disease. That's what you are going to stay on all the time. That's what you have to take. That is the mainstream MS medicine. I'm always surprised by patients that come in and they'll talk about one of their symptom management medications and think that it is their MS medicine. So there's also the symptom management medications, and those are for all of the varied symptoms. Fatigue, there's bladder bowels, there's medicine for muscle spasms, there's medicines for all of the different symptoms that you have. And then there's the relapse management. When you have a new active disease and you have relapse, like Dr. Hunger talked about with the IV steroids and the Acthar. So why should you take your disease-modifying therapy? Here are just a few reasons, definitely not comprehensive. So strict adherence to your disease-modifying therapy results in optimal functioning. There's been multiple studies shown that prove that. For improved quality of life, all of us want the best quality of life we can lead. So if, even though you have this disease, you have MS, you still want to function, want to have a good quality of life, and we want to get there the best way we can. Decreased inpatient and outpatient visits equals lower MS-related medical cost. So adherence to therapy is important even for healthcare, even for government, saving money. Reduction in number of new lesions on the MRI. That's what your MS DMT can do for you. Reduction in progression of disability. It also has probable reduction in future disease activity and reduction in the number of relapses that you may have. So when I say relapses, I want to make sure that we know the difference in a pseudo-relapse and a relapse. When I say pseudo, I don't mean that it's fake or it's not real. It does feel real, and it's very real to you. You have very, very real symptoms of it. But a pseudo relapse is usually not new disease. It's not a new MRI lesion causing these deficits, no new deficits. And it's usually brought on by external factors like heat, like stress. There's multiple factors that can bring pseudo relapses on. Even infections like a urinary tract infection, that is usually the main thing that I see that brings pseudo-relapses on in patients. And it feels very much the same as a relapse, and people are very confused about the difference. But this is old, old things that you've had before, old disease, old deficits that are getting worse and kind of fluctuate and come and go. Clinical relapse is when you have a new neurological deficit, and the definition is that it lasts more than 24 hours. Of course, it can last, and it usually will last a lot longer than that. You have new disease, new lesions on the MRI. And with new relapses, over 40% of people have a permanent deficit. So maybe you were dealing with what you had thus far. You're dealing with your left leg weakness, numbness, tingling. And when you don't go on any therapy, or you don't have the right therapy for you, and you have progression, you may have a new deficit. Your right arm has never been numb, never been weak. Well, now it is. Well, the longer treatment is delayed, then you have a better chance of ending up with that permanent deficit as well as the other permanent deficit you had before. So we're going to talk a little bit about compliance and adherence to your therapies. Compliance, the definition, usually implies a unilateral decision, expectation that if the provider prescribes something, that you're going to take it. So it's kind of being told what to do. So I say you take this, and you're going to take it. End of story. Adherence is a little bit better for everybody, I think. It implies a mutual agreement, an agreement between the provider and the patient that the patient can follow and the provider will support. So some statistics. 32 million Americans take 3 or more medications. More than 50% of Americans do not follow their provider's plan. 75% are expected to be non-adherent at any given point in time. And 29% of Americans stop taking their medication before it runs out. The medication non-adherence adds $290 billion in avoidable healthcare costs. That number kind of surprised me. So, what are some factors that affect treatment adherence? Well, how was the diagnosis delivered? Did your doctor or neurologist or nurse practitioner walk in the room and tell you, okay, looks like you've got an MS, here's a list of medicines, we'll see you in 3 months? I mean, I wouldn't want to take that either, right? Do you have trust in your provider? Do you have a good relationship with them? Do you have access to care? There's psychosocial factors. Anxiety, fear of the unknown, fear of new medicines, fear of the disease, depression. A man came up to me after one of my talks and told me that nobody ever really talked about the depression a whole lot that came along with MS. And that was, you know, he didn't have any physical symptoms, but depression, it really plagued him to the point of almost suicidal depression. And he wanted to hear, you know, more about this, but that is a very big factor that plays into part. And it especially plays into part if you're going to take your medication or not. Because if you're depressed and don't really care about anything, including yourself, you're not going to take your medicine. You're not going to adhere to therapy. Do you have any family support? Do you have financial support? It really saddens me when my patients come in and tell me, you know, my husband, wife, daughters don't believe I have MS. They say that I'm just a hypochondriac and I like taking medicine. I want to take all this. They say there's nothing in the world wrong with me. And that's one of the things about MS. Sometimes you don't look like there's anything wrong with you. You look normal. You look fine, but nobody knows what's going on the inside. So you have some disbelief. Well, that's going to make it hard to take a medication because your family doesn't support you. even if you are going to take it and you want to for yourself, you're probably going to hide that medicine, hide that medication, and take it and not let them be aware of it. And that's difficult. Your support system, insurance. Insurances get in the way a lot of times. They have denials or won't let you be on a certain medication that your provider and you agree on. So you kind of have to look at all of the factors here. And if you don't have enough money for your co-pays, if you don't have financial support, there are a lot of the drug companies where some of them you can get these medicines for free. So be sure to look into all that. Cognitive dysfunction, forgetting. Lack of understanding, like I talked about before. Lack of knowledge, lack of understanding the relapses and what they are and the perceived benefit, expectations. What are these medications supposed to do? And then the side effects of these medications. The side effects can be severe on a lot of these medications. If you don't feel good and the medication makes you feel bad, you're not going to want to take it. So some strategies to improve adherence, some things that you can do to help yourself and to maybe become more adherent to your medication. So find your match. Find your match with your provider. Find the provider that you feel comfortable with, somebody that you can talk to, somebody that doesn't make you feel like you're asking a dumb question. A lot of my patients tell me that as well. They say, you know, this may be dumb, but I have this itch, and it's this deep itch. You'd be surprised. There are a lot more patients that have those same things. We hear that quite often. So even though it's not listed as one of the symptoms, or you're not supposed to have that as MS, with MS, it doesn't mean that others don't, and it doesn't mean that you don't have it. Pain wasn't even supposed to be associated with MS a long time ago, and now we know that it is. So your follow-up visits, make sure to keep your follow-up visits. After you start a therapy, you will probably develop more questions. You'll have, if you have any reactions, if you have any problems, you know, make sure that your provider is going to be there for you to answer those questions. And if you're not able to get a follow-up visit, then, or shortly after, or right when you have the questions, do they have nursing staff? Do they have somebody that's going to be there to answer those questions for you? So questions, they alleviate fear. They alleviate fear of the unknown. And also because these medications have these package inserts that are scary. So after you're prescribed this medication, you're told that you have MS. That's a shock to some. Then you're given this disease-modifying therapy, and you get home and you start reading this stuff. I mean, highlighted, can cause death. I'm not taking that. So you may not know some of the things in the inserts or in the literature, and some of them may not be as bold as they make. A lot of these were listed as side effects during the trials, and the side effect might have happened in a very small number of patients, like 0.3% of the entire trial. So talk to your healthcare provider and see if, you know, this is a symptom or a side effect that is very frequent, or really what your odds or chances are, and then decide if you want to deal with that or not. Be your own advocate. Knowledge is power. The more knowledge you have about the disease, the better you're going to be able to advocate for yourself, the better you're going to be able to know what treatments may be right, may be helpful, what treatments, if you know what they've done in any studies and any comparisons. So be your own advocate. Support groups, very important. I know that we have a very good support group in my area, and I think you do here as well. So support groups, and even if you're not able to get out to support groups, they have Facebook support groups now. They have all kinds of things that you can go on the internet and get involved with. The patient programs like this, and then the drug companies put on patient programs. So if you hear of any of those, go get more information. Counseling is always very important. Talking to somebody else about this may very well help you. Counseling has been shown to decrease depression as well. So it's very important, because this is something that is big. It's the rest of your life. You may need to talk to somebody about it, especially if you don't have that support of your family. I talked about the patient assistance programs. Expectations. So what are the expectations you have for these disease-modifying therapies? A big misconception is these therapies are going to alleviate all your symptoms. So you have disease. When you go in, you get diagnosed, you have these lesions, this disease already there, these scarred areas, these pathways that are damaged. So from time to time, as I talked about the pseudo-relapses, you're still going to have these flare-ups. You could have permanent damage where you're walking with a cane now. This is already there. We can prescribe medication that will help with this, but the disease-modifying therapies, these are meant to keep you from having any new disease. So that's just a point that I want to hit home, because these are not meant for symptom management. However, there are some of these therapies that do help with some symptoms. That's just an added bonus, and I love hearing when that happens too. Side effects. There's all kinds of ways to manage side effects. I could go into the list of side effects on all the medicine and tell you how to manage each one. Obviously, I don't have time today, but we'll just run into a few right now. With Tecfidera, sometimes you'll have that flushing, and it's very difficult to manage to take that medicine twice a day and have flushing with it. So patients will just quit the medication. So aspirin, as simple as that, taking an aspirin with it, that could help. Ibuprofen with the injectables, it can help. It can help alleviate some of the pain with the injectables if you take that before. Antihistamine, that histamine response, that redness that you get, sometimes that can help. Cold compress, or we'll even sometimes prescribe a numbing patch to put in the area that you are going to inject. So you put it on there and get that area numb and then take it off and inject, and it's not as painful. Or a cold compress, that will sometimes help. Some of these you have to take with food. Some of these you don't need to take with food. Some in the morning, some in the evening. You need to know these things. You need to talk to your provider about these things and figure out kind of how to adjust. There are some that have dosage titrations. That may help. That may help you get adjusted more, get your body more attuned to this, and help you in alleviating side effects. So information we talked about earlier, there MS Views and News is an invaluable source. It is wonderful. They have links to almost anything you would want for information. They have the wonderful YouTube videos that have MS specialists that talk about almost everything from side effects to therapies, new therapies, different ways to manage. And he's doing more and more. Stuart's doing these all the time. So they're continuing to be posted. The MS Society. MS Society is great, a great resource. There's MS One-to-One. A lot of the different drug companies have resources available that you can use. So, forgetting. Forgetting was listed as the most common reason for non-adherence. Any of you ever feel like this? Did I take that this morning or was that yesterday? Have I done that yet? I can't remember. I even do that sometimes. Things will get hectic, a lot of stuff going on. One kid will come ask me one thing, another thing, and then I forgot. Now, what was I doing? So, it's very common to forget if you've taken your medication, even especially the orals. So here are some different things that you might can do that would help. There have these cool medication alert watches now that will tell you when it's time to take these things, and it will automatically, after you hit okay, go into your phone, maybe into your app that you have installed, and check for that day. They're the blister packs. These blister packs with the orals you can push out, and then you'll know, they're listed by days, you'll know which one you've taken and which one you haven't. That is, if you take it immediately after you push it out of the blister pack and don't lay it down and do something else. They're smart pill containers. These are like those regular containers that you pop up all week, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, except when you open the lid, it also sends a message to your phone or device that says you've taken it for that day. All kinds of mobile technology. There's a lot of different apps to use. If you combine it with a daily task, sometimes it's easier. One suggestion is maybe lay the pill beside your toothbrush in the morning, and hopefully everybody brushes their teeth and will take their medicine at that time too. Set an alarm. It doesn't have to be the fancy phone or tablet or those kind of alarms. Just set an alarm as a reminder to take or to do your injection. Keep it visible if possible. If you don't have children or pets around where you can keep it in your vision, in your sight, that may be helpful. Enlist help. Enlist help from family and friends. Get your brother, sister, mother, father to call you. When some of these are every third day or every other week or every other day, then it's sometimes hard to remember. So let them mark that calendar. Sit down with you and mark your calendar so they can call you and remind you. And then once it becomes a routine, it will be easier, hopefully. Okay, so since Dr. Legant couldn't make it today, I've brought a little bit of his suggestions with me. This is what we're doing. This is what we are trying to do when we're trying to adhere to these therapies. This is what we're trying to accomplish here. He calls it his home run of therapy. So what do we want? We want no changes on your MRI, no new lesions, nothing new. That's what we want this to do. We want it, of course, to be well-tolerated and safe, and that is very important to you because if you're taking this medication, it's doing what it's supposed to do, but you feel crappy and you don't want to get out of your house, you don't want to do anything, then how is that improving your quality of life? So well-tolerated, no relapses. We want to keep those relapses at bay. We want these disease therapies to do this, to keep those at bay, no relapses. And be stable on your neurological exam. There are 90% of new MRI lesions don't cause symptoms. So that's a little shocking. It just wait till that right one hits that right pathway, and that's when you get these symptoms. But if you follow up regularly with your neurologist, have regular MRIs, then a lot of times, or most of the time, they will do a neurological assessment on you when you come in. So do they notice new weakness? Do they notice something that's different than before that they haven't noticed before? This may be where your neurological exam is not stable, and that might suggest something new. So you would want to look into that. Okay, so one thing I did not mention is on inability or physical limitations in taking your disease-modifying therapies. Some patients have told me those blister packs, even though helpful for some, they can't really open because they have tremors. Tremors won't let them get those pills out of that pack. Or your range of motion is not enough to do different injection sites and rotate the sites. Or there's difficulties that maybe we can help manage. So I'm going to talk a little bit about different rehabilitation now. So why rehab? Because you have to relearn how to do tasks. You have to relearn sometimes things like walking, grooming, talking, and even thinking. You've got to relearn how to do those things because everything's a jumbled mess right now. And I know that that's what a lot of you feel like. So some benefits. Prevent falls. Improve your quality of life. Enhance moods. Exercise and therapy have been proven to enhance moods. Decrease disease progression. Combat depression. And decrease your fatigue. I know that's kind of we want you to go to therapy, we want you to do exercises, but you have this MS fatigue that you don't even want to get out of bed. Why would you want to go to therapy or do exercises? Well, studies have shown that once you start doing these exercises or this rehabilitation, then it will help that fatigue and help any depression. And so maybe you will get up and maybe you'll be able and maybe you'll want to do more things. And then you'll be able, hopefully, to do more things. So the different types of rehab, it's not comprehensive. We've got the physical therapy, occupational therapy, cognitive rehabilitation. All of these things help. They've been proven in studies, multiple ones that have shown that they do help with your symptoms, with your disease progression. So there's different places that can provide these therapies. There's home health that can come to you and give you these therapies at home. There's group rehabs now that you can go to with a group of MS patients that are doing these same types of rehab. And then there's rehab centers that you can go to. Right here in Birmingham, the Tanner Center with Dr. Reiser has a wonderful center. They have their rehabilitation center right in their office. So, and all of their therapists are multiple sclerosis certified. So they know exactly what you need, what MS patients need in their physical therapy or occupational therapy. So they're designed specifically for you. So what are you doing when you're doing some of this therapy? You are building new connections between nerve cells. Sometimes you're building, I think of it as bridges or alternate routes or strengthening the routes that's damaged. So you've got to somehow try to get that function back, and the earlier the better. So rehab is very important. Physical therapy. What can physical therapy do for you? Well, pain management for one, stretching techniques. If any of you feel that muscle spasticity, that it's hard to get out of bed, they can show you how to do different stretching techniques that may help with that, that may even alleviate that sometimes. Strengthening is very important. It's hard to get up and down now because your legs are weak. Well, they'll give you ways that you can manage to strengthen. Even if you're in a wheelchair or even if you do use a cane, any of that, they can still give you specific exercises that will help with your rehabilitation. The exercise programs are designed for you. A few that have shown benefit are water aerobics, and that's easier on your muscles. It's easier on you. You may can do that where you couldn't do another kind of therapy. Yoga, Tai Chi, even range of motion exercises. Those are always good. They can show you and teach you how to improve your posture, which in turn will help with your balance and help you walk better. Core strengthening. Core strengthening is the key to a lot of times with your balance and with your posture. You may not even know that you have a slumped over posture to the left. It may be so normal for you now that you don't recognize that. They recognize those things, show you different positions that may help. They will help with balance. So with balance, that's another, that vertigo type feeling, the on a roller coaster, sometimes make you nauseated, sick, that feeling. It wasn't supposed to be associated with MS. Now we're finding more and more that it is. But you still want to make sure that it's not something else that could be easily fixed. If you have the vertigo, a lot of times the physical therapist, occupational therapist can do different maneuvers to figure out kind of which is the problem. Is it vertigo where you have the crystals off in your ear? Have they gotten all jumbled up? And they can do certain head procedures, lean in your head certain ways to reset these, and that way you'll feel better and you won't have that constant sense of dizziness anymore. Now, not always, it's not always that. Obviously, MS does on its own cause that. But if it was, wouldn't you want it to be treated and get rid of it? That's the vestibular rehab that I was talking about. So occupational therapy. Occupational therapy will show you different ways to think about things, different ways to do things, different ways to manage fatigue with cooling, pacing, energy conservation, home safety. Are there modifications that could be made in your home that may help benefit you, that may help conserve energy? Or is there a rug that you keep tripping over, but it's been there for so long you don't really realize it? Well, they may realize these things. They can give you alternative ways of doing things. They can help choose which mobility device you may need. Do you need a cane, a walker, a chair? Then there's speech therapy. Speech therapy, when you're having difficulty swallowing, they can do a modified barium swallow or different types of swallowing assessments to see what the problem is. Then there's speech exercises that can help you with your speech. Cognitive rehab. So neurocognitive testing is always good. It can help identify where you're having the most difficulties. Cognitive rehabilitation can help you minimize your cognitive load. They can show you how maybe do pre-made lists, set a routine, organization that may help. There's computerized exercises now, mind exercises, mind games that you can keep your mind stimulated. There's strategies that will help with memory, memory notebooks, calendars, reminders, alarms, and then problem solving. They can show you how to problem solve when you can't really think of how to do that anymore. This is a poem. I don't know if any of you have seen it yet. This one of my very best friends and colleagues has MS, and this is her favorite thing, so she wanted me to put it in here. This is the Dr. Seuss poem. It says, I love MS. It's just so neat, the way it swept me off my feet. I love the pain. I love the numb and sticking needles in my bum. I love the way my words are blur, the way I shake, the words I slur. I love my chair and walker, too. I love my MS. I do. I love my lazy, sleepy days. I shake with joy within my haze. I'm just as happy as can be. It makes me pee and pee and pee. I love my legs that will not walk, my twisted tongue that will not talk. I love the way my poop does bind. I do believe I've lost my mind. I know this resonates with a lot of you in here. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time.
All right, everybody, we're going to do a Q&A, and this is how we do this, all right? Both clinicians are going to be up on top. They're going to have one microphone, I believe. And Ken is going to be on one side of the room, and I'm going to be on the other side of the room, and we're going to take turns, all right? And I know that you have a lot of questions out there, so we have about 40 minutes to do this, okay? And who's going to be first? And don't say nobody. Thank you. He's going to come on over because Ken's got that side of the room. Thank you.
Okay. If you have been diagnosed over 30 years, have not had a relapse, new lesions, or symptoms in more than 10 years, at age 66, what drug-modifying therapy do you suggest?
Whichever one your doctor thinks is the right treatment. But the whole thing is very complex, and no new lesions is always a good thing, no new problems. But if people have disability, that's a different situation. And what exactly an individual's problems are, if someone really is a rare person who meets the definitions for primary progressive MS, which is probably, in my estimate, less than 5% of people with MS, there is a treatment coming. And that treatment's already actually available for free if you go and look for it, called it's called the Early Access Program. It's considered a research trial, but everybody gets the treatment. I imagine one or two of the local neurologists will be involved with that, and that's for this drug ocrelizumab. But and that drug works for MS regardless of the kind of MS it is. So, but that is, it is available to people who meet certain criteria now through a research trial. I mean, we have that at our site, but I'm sure there's at least one that's going to open up here soon.
All right. Before I go to the next one, I had a question that somebody wrote in on Facebook, and they wanted Amanda to answer this. All right, and that is that when they want to know how it is that the nurse practitioners work best with like a patient, a person that's coming in that was just newly diagnosed. How do you give them the comfort that they need, and how do you work with their family to show them that they're going to be able to trust those that are now responsible for their health care?
A lot of times that is how nurse practitioners are utilized, different ways, but sometimes the nurse practitioner can spend a little bit more time with the patient than the physician can. Sometimes the physician has that opportunity, but we'll sit down and go over and let you know what the disease is, what options you have, and pretty much about what I talked about here, the different treatments, different kinds of medication. I know that some centers have a new patient diagnosis clinic where they'll let their patients and families come in so many days a month. I think Dr. Reiser has that as well, the Tanner Center. She has where they have specific dates that they'll bring a few different patients and their family members in and spend about 3 hours really going over what MS is and how to help you and how to help you help yourself.
Well, the biggest problem I've had with my MS has not been my taking my medications, but actually talking with compensation boards or the social welfare system. You tell people this is going to cause me problems or I can't handle these kind of situations, they put it on you anyway.
I will say problems people have with MS are sometimes interpreted as psychiatric issues, even if they're not psychiatric issues, and that those are handled differently through disability systems. But the basics of Social Security disability and any disability system is whether or not you can do a job. And if you can't do a job because of your illness, you're supposed to be able to get the benefit. And the Social Security system, many times, because they have established guidelines for MS that are 40 years out of date, this requires going to court and having an attorney to represent you. Because the judges are actually very reasonable. Their question is, are they sick? Can they work because of their illness? Or technically, if you can't work full time, you're still disabled. You know, so these things. But the system is kind of antiquated, and I've had people say who have one finger and one eye, them tell them they should be able to operate in an elevator. You know, but if you can't work full time, whether it's fatigue, or concentration, or your bladder, or your walking, or your hands, you're disabled. You know, but it may take time for the system to work for you.
Yes, I got a question. Is there a prescription medication that can be provided for severe itching?
There are different things that can be tried. What I have found that has worked, at least with some of my patients, are, well, it's an off-label use, but it's Vimpat, which is an anti-epileptic drug that I have found helps with that deep inside itch. Because a lot of times what you're feeling is those nerve sensations or those nerve impulses that are kind of going crazy or hitting those scarred areas and causing that sensation. So that has helped, or some of the other anti-epileptic medicines may have. There's also specific medication that can help with itching that are prescribed for that. Like, and then some of the antihistamines may help. And Dr. Hunter may have some more.
Yeah, we call it neuropathic itching if there's nothing wrong with your skin. You know, and you know, you can tell if there's something wrong with your skin, it's that's causing the itching. But number one is gabapentin works really well, and number two is hydroxyzine. Number three is carbamazepine or Dilantin or some other anti-epileptic drug will also work. And you just have to try different ones. But gabapentin is usually the one that works the first time, in my experience.
Oh. I've seen a lot of research or ads on Facebook about the stem cell research that's being done, and I tracked down the facility, I'm sorry, I stutter, the facility that's doing it, and I sent my doctor the information requirements about it, and he said that I would have to be off my Tysabri for at least 6 months to be able to qualify for that stem cell research. But my question is, the stem cell research that they're doing, it supposedly helps you revert back to your normal self. Like, I have I'm disabled because I can't walk, my hands don't work, and the stem cell therapy is supposed to help you get back to the way you were. Is that true or not?
Well, this is a very good question, and I think it's very hard for people with MS to evaluate these things that are presented to them. Let me tell you, there are some legitimate research things, but there is a company called Stemgenics in California that says, come participate in our research trial, where you pay them $15,000 to $30,000 or something in that range, and you have to put $2,500 down even to have an appointment with them. This is they are a scam organization. What they do is unproven. The only reason they have a research trial is because the feds were going to put them all in jail. And I kid you not, this is actually a fact. This is they were just about to put them in jail, and they said, "Well, we're doing research, and people are just paying to participate in a trial." You don't pay that kind of money for a legitimate organization. Those people are people who are lining their pockets with your hard-earned money. Now, there are legitimate research that goes on. Anybody who tells you that stem cells are going to make your MS better is lying to you, okay? Because they don't have the data to say that. All right? And they may, somebody who presents you as a patient, come up there and say, here's our patient. They just say it's wonderful and their fatigue is all gone. They're lying to you, okay? These are scam artists. Don't fall for it. Now, there are legitimate research that goes on. There's a few institutions that do this. These medicines are chemotherapy medicines, very, very large, toxic doses of chemotherapy medicines. The research that has been done that you have seen reported out where they say they're getting great results, studies that were started 10 to 15 years ago, before we had all the wonderful new medicines we had, including Lymtrada, which is, if you haven't taken Lymtrada, you haven't had really effective treatment for MS in the long term yet. That is the number one effective medicine for MS, and is straightforward and it's easy to use. Tysabri is a great medicine. It's just not a long-term solution for many people. But it's a good medicine, too. If people have disabling, MS that's getting worse, these are the medicines that are the heavy lifters that take care of you. The things about the real scientific research, it is not stem cell research. It is chemotherapy research where they give you stem cells to protect you against the toxic effects of the chemotherapy. And it is a cancer treatment. It's an established cancer treatment. It's used routinely to treat some cancer patients. And it does work for MS, but it is far more dangerous and toxic than almost every other treatment we have. And it is not necessary to take those kind of risks. And it's certainly not necessary to spend your own money if you're insured to get good treatment for your MS. So that's the best way I can put it. And, there are people out there who disagree with me, who are patients, who've done these things. I can only tell you that the experience I've had with people who've gone and done this has been disastrous or disappointing.
Thank you.
I got one more question. Do you know if there's any association with chest pains for MS? I've had testing for my heart, and it's not heart related, but I'm constantly having chest pains. So I just want to know if that's related to MS.
Sometimes patients have what's called an MS hug that can be mistaken for chest pain. A squeezing kind of right underneath the rib cage. Some describe it as a pressure more than a squeezing. And a lot of times that has to do with lesions or MS lesions that are in your spinal cord that cause those that squeezing type pain. I've had a lot of patients that have been to the emergency room thinking that they had chest pain, and which it does hurt there, but after they were cleared by a cardiologist, all of their heart problems came, all their heart tests came back normal, then sometimes it ends up being just the MS hug. Muscle relaxers a lot of times will help that. Baclofen is very good, that I found anyway, to help with the MS hug. And it kind of alleviate that and make it a little bit more tolerable sometimes. It doesn't work for everybody. Sometimes that lesion is there and causes you problems all the time like that.
I've had MS since I was 12 years old. And it's gotten worse as I've gotten older, of course. I diagnosed when I was 34. One of those thought I was crazy. And I have things like PBA. As a child, I had PBA, and I said, oh, it's so funny, it's so funny, it's laughing all the time. Well, I'm laughing fine, I'm laughing. But I'm older now, I don't laugh. I cry. I sit on the couch just for no reason. Just like tears and blubbering like a baby. No reason. My dogs are going crazy, and they don't watch for me. I don't know either. I can't stop it. And the doctor says, oh, just let it go away. Don't go away, don't worry about that. No, but it's not serious. It's serious to me. I said, all day long crying. It's serious to me.
Very serious. That could be a few different things, like the pseudobulbar effect that you were speaking of. There is a medication for that, Nudexta. That's the only medication that has been FDA approved for that. And sometimes you can get a combination of some depression along with the pseudobulbar effect, and this can cause even more damage. So maybe you haven't got the right medicine, the right treatment that will control your depression, and if that is what it is, in combination with these. You kind of have to try a few different things sometimes until you can get it under control. There are, and which are a little bit helpful now, there's what's called an alpha genomics test, and they do a swab inside your mouth. And if you've tried numerous medications, like a bucket list, long list, and none of them worked, or they had horrible side effects, or whatever the case, and what these tests do, it just tells you how you metabolize these things and what you may be a high metabolizer of or immediate, and what may, it's a suggestion, but what may work better for you.
The comments, this PBA problem is a problem that a minority of MS patients have. It's distinct from depression, which most MS patients have. Most MS patients benefit from antidepressant medication. They feel better. Their brains work better when they take it. But PBA is a different medicine required for that. It's called Nudexta. It is very effective at reducing the number of episodes. And it may be mild, and it doesn't really bother people, or it may be severe and disrupt everybody because people have such intense negative emotions or inappropriate emotions, and they're not really depressed. And so it's something a doctor helps you sort out, and it's a very difficult thing to treat on occasion, but since Nudexta came along, it hasn't been that much of a problem because the medicine works so well for it. And the other thing I would say about antidepressants is antidepressants make MS better. There's evidence to that. So there's no reason that if you need them, you shouldn't take them.
Next question over here.
Even if you're feeling the same physically, does a new MRI lesion signify a relapse? Does it equate to a relapse?
That's a good question. When we talk about relapse, we mean symptoms that are obvious to a patient or their doctor. But a new MRI lesion is what we call disease activity. And it is concerning, especially because the way we measure them in research trials, it's very subtle changes. When an x-ray doctor tells your neurologist that you have a new lesion, it is not a trivial problem. It is something happened major, and they need to control it. it. And getting the MS better controlled is an exercise in trying to decide how to do things. If it just happened, if you just got on a new treatment a few months ago and they're not sure, or the medicine's still beginning its phase of working the first 6 months, your doctor might not do anything about that. But if you've been on treatment a while and all of a sudden there's a new lesion, it means that treatment isn't controlling the MS adequately, and they sit down and they review what else can we do to get it better controlled in the future. And sometimes that's going to a new medicine, or one possibly even with more risks, or one that works differently. And that's something, a decision you make speaking with your doctor.
In the back.
I know it's case by case, but if you've been on Tysabri for over a year, what would be something that would say, let me try Lemtrada? I know you would need to go or speak to your doctor about it. But for example, my husband has been on Tysabri for a while, at least 2-3 years now. And he feels as though some of his symptoms are worsening. He recently had a relapse episode about 2 weeks ago, so he went through the Sildenafil. But what would be some kind of indication to make that switch?
Of course, that would be up to your provider and also up to insurance, it seems, these days. So there's a new policy in place, at least at Blue Cross of Alabama, that you have to have failed 3 other treatments. So that means you had to have put the time in, taken the treatment, and failed that either by the side effects from it that you could not tolerate, or disease progression. And the stickler in that with the Tysabri part is they've also now added that you if your reason for failure is being JC virus positive, that you have to have been on Tysabri at least 2 years. So those 3 factors. But with him, it sounds like he may have met all of those factors, and that's just a conversation for your provider. If you're not doing well, you're not meeting that home run, right, that I talked about. So, or with your new MRI disease, you're not meeting all those qualifications. So if you don't meet all of those things, then it's time to sit down with your provider and talk about it and say, you know, what other options are there for me? What else might, where could I go from here? Because the current therapy is just not meeting my goals.
Absolutely. But, you know, the reality is that the majority of people with MS won't be controlled on anything short of something like Lemtrada or Tysabri, and still 40 to 50% will still have something new. But they're just much milder symptoms on effective treatment, and your doctor is going to be the best one to make that decision. And the important thing is that if something changes and it's a big problem for you, you need to go to your doctor and say, I think I'm having a relapse. I want to get steroids and see if it gets better. We have people wait and wait and wait, and they're very disabled for many months sometimes before we see them, and they have a problem that could have been made better very quickly.
Before I go on to the next question, I have an interesting one for you that I've never heard asked or answered. And that is, if a person does Lemtrada, and they go through all that, and 6 months down the line, they find that this person is actually getting worse, then what?
Well, that happens. You know, people have bad MS, and bad MS is still going to be bad MS after you get Lemtrada. It's just going to be better than it was otherwise. And so about 25% of people who get Lemtrada 5 years will be worse, and the rest of them are stable or better. In fact, my experience is, having treated 150 people for 10 years, is they're usually significantly better 5 years later on average. But there's 25% that are still going to keep having more problems. What is that problem? It's usually a leg. They had a bad leg to start with. That leg is worse. Or they were barely walking and they can't walk because that leg has just gotten worse.
So that being said, though, are they allowed to then be put onto another medication that they, if they were never on Tysabri, could they then be put onto Tysabri? How will the insurance companies look at that? And is there a washout period of any sort from then being on the Lemtrada?
That's a good question. We haven't run into that problem very much for the main reason that Lemtrada works well enough that it doesn't happen very often. But there are people that keep having several relapses a year, and you have to decide what to do with them. It takes time for the immune system to get back towards normal. With Tysabri, the problem with Tysabri is if somebody has life-threatening MS, nobody has a problem with using Tysabri. If it's limb-threatening MS, the risks of the PML go up with any strong treatment of the immune system. So if you've ever had a positive test for JC virus, that risk is around 3% of having this life-threatening brain infection with Tysabri. So that said, there are some people where that doesn't matter, and you just go right on ahead. And there are some people who clearly don't have any reaction to that virus at all and probably are not infected in a long term, and that's not a big issue either if they have difficult MS using Tysabri. But most of the time when people go back on another medicine, it's several years after the Lemtrada, and they are having new problems again, and they haven't tried one of the effective oral medicines before, and they're going to try that, and basically what you're getting is a combination of the benefit of the Lemtrada and the benefit of the other treatment. Insurance companies haven't ever balked unless they've just gotten Lemtrada or something, and in that situation, you just don't usually use anything other than steroids for a relapse, because it just isn't a very common scenario. But people will have relapses, and people can have new problems even after highly effective MS medicines.
So was that after, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think in the studies it showed where only 5% of patients in the studies had to actually go on a different treatment. So was that after the first year, the first therapy, that the question, or was it after the second?
It's my question.
Okay. So after the first year, you've got to remember, you've only had, when you have the Lemtrada, you have 5 days the first year, and then the next year you repeat it for 3 days, same process. So you have to remember that if it was a relapse during the middle of that, then you've only had half of the treatment. You haven't had the full treatment, so it'd be taking like half of a pill that you would expect to do the full job. It's probably not going to. And the majority of patients that I have seen have had kind of a downhill progression. Now, not necessarily new disease, but just kind of feel bad until about month 4 and then start coming back up. And that's just in my experience. But once you have that second year, most people did well with no new lesions. But that also brings me back to what's there is already there. You have those scarred areas, and this treatment, like the others, is not made to clear that area up, although this one did show that it does that on some occasions, but that's a bonus. That's what I was talking about. But now you've had this treatment, you've completed it, you don't have to take anything else ever. You don't have to get an injection every other day, you don't have to go once a month, and no new progression. And that's what the goal of that treatment is.
Thank you for that answer.
And I would add, the company can't tell you how much better you get with that treatment. They're not allowed to by the government. Your doctor has to tell you that, because you won't hear it. They can't post it on a website or things because the government hasn't approved them. But the average person improves in disability. And it really is delayed quite a while in some cases into beyond the second year. Usually it's towards the end of the second year people say, hey, something's changed. I'm feeling better. But half of people are still improving after 2 years. It's a very, very long-term treatment. It's completely different than other therapies.
Great. Thank you for those answers.
How everyone doing? Okay, thank you. How everyone doing? I got diagnosed with MS 3 years ago, and up until a few months ago, I was told about probable MS. Can you explain that to me?
What was it you were told about MS?
Probable MS.
Probable MS.
Yes, can you explain that to me?
So here's how, because MS is something that requires almost a detective to figure out in some cases, because sometimes it's milder and less obvious when it starts. And that has a good side and a bad side. It can delay a diagnosis. But the old term probable MS, it was used a long time ago for people that they couldn't be sure about, but had a had only one symptom. So nowadays, we don't use this term very much because they've either had something or they haven't. And if you have a symptom that's typical of MS and you have an abnormal MRI, and you can have MS with a normal MRI, by the way, it's just not as common. But if you have an abnormal MRI, then you're called first symptom MS or early MS, clinically isolated syndrome. Some doctors still use the older terms pre-MS or probable MS, but most of those people should be treated, you know, in the current framework of recommendation.
Has MS and burning in the leg, are they associated? Is that a symptom associated with it? And I've had an MRI, but it hasn't been any kind of indication that I had any new lesions on my spine or anything like that. So it's been recommended that it's coming from my back. So, but, you know.
Yes, it could be a sign of MS. It could also be a sign of other things like neuropathies or a lumbar radiculopathy where you've got a nerve compressed in your back. It could be a number of things, and that's why you need to present it to your provider and let them know exactly how it came on, what it feels like, what makes it better, what makes it worse, and that way you can kind of get to the bottom of it. There, but burning, stinging, that sort of pain is common in MS. It's common in those other things that I mentioned too. And there's a lot of, back to that question, there's, brings me to that, like you said, being a detective. So there's a lot of diseases, there's a lot of physical problems, there's a lot of mechanical problems that can imitate MS to the T. There are some diseases that can imitate the symptoms of MS, also have brain lesions like MS, and just identical to it. So it's very hard to distinguish, you know, the difference there. So you need someone who's going to help you make it through that and determine what is causing the problem, okay? And that way, once you know what's causing the problem, you'll know which direction to go to fix the problem. Those anti-epileptic medicines that we were talking about earlier a lot of times help with that if it is MS-related and if it is that nerve pain, even if it's a different kind of nerve pain.
We only have time for one more question on each side of the room. Do you have any down there?
Okay. Well, first I want to say, Everybody needs a little cheerleader like I've got back here.
Okay.
You want to see her? So, yeah. She's my personal cheerleader. I suggest get a cheerleader. They don't have to dress like mine, but you have a cheerleader. Have somebody in your corner.
Awesome. Thank you.
Question. Related to vaccinations that contain live viruses, should any be avoided, such as the flu shot, pneumonia, tetanus, whatever?
We do suggest that all live virus vaccines be avoided with MS. You already have an overactive immune system where your cells are kind of fighting off. That's what it is, that they go and attack the myelin. So when you've already got that overactive immune system, you don't want to add anything else to it that can cause you more problems. Plus, you can sometimes get sick from those, very sick. And
does that include shingles and what?
Let's give a list. And in general, live virus vaccines, people get those as children, so they're not an issue for the most part. There's only one that people get as an adult routinely right now, and that's the shingles or zoster vaccine, as it's called, which is a dose of a weak chickenpox virus. Next year, that's going to change. Next year, there's going to be a new shingles vaccine that's better, and it's not a live virus, and it works three times as well as the old one. So that will change. Now, if you're traveling, for example, and somebody wants you to get the yellow fever vaccine or the encephalitis vaccine, those are live virus vaccines, and you shouldn't get them. But in general, it's probably safe to get live virus vaccines with MS, except for the people who are on stronger immune medicines. It's actually been tested, and it's not a big problem, but it's not recommended. So it's an individual call. People with really weak immune systems should not, you know, you've gotten a lot of medicines, should not take live virus. But that does not include the vast majority of vaccines that are recommended for you. People with MS should get the flu vaccine every year. They should get, there are two different pneumonia vaccines. You should get each of them every 5 years. These save lives. You should get your tetanus shot. You should get a pertussis vaccine again. And these are really important.
Do you have any on that site? Yes, that's the last one. We can only take one more.
Okay, I've noticed that on all the disease-modifying treatments, there's a caveat if you're 65 and over, on the new ones that come out, say if you're 65 and over, you know how to do this. Okay, how is that with Lemtrada?
There's many different aspects of this. Some providers say that when you're at a certain age, you don't need treatment anymore. I'm not in that corner at all. 100% on the other side. You know, it is quality of life. Some 80-year-olds have just a good of quality of life and are very active as a 20-year-old, my grandfather being one of them. But you just because you've hit a certain age doesn't mean that you are not appropriate for treatment by any means in my book. And for the Lemtrada, no, we have had quite a few patients. I think actually my mean age in one of the research things I did was 60. So a lot of the patients, and a lot of times if you've had MS for a long time and you've had the time to try three different treatments, then sometimes it is that age. But in the two different studies, it was studied on people that were naive to treatment and people who had failed prior treatment as well. So it gave a little bit of both categories.
I would second, the MS does not burn out. Anybody who told you your MS is burned out is not paying attention in most cases. If I'm wrong, that's fine, but 95% of the time we're not wrong about that. MS does not burn out, and you really, really have a risk of it getting worse in the years after stopping treatment, and you don't need that after many years of success.
All right, well, let's thank our two speakers here today. Thank you very much.